Good morning, church. Welcome to our video broadcast. We miss each of you very much, and we're looking forward to getting to meet here again. We hope sooner than later.
Yes.
Aren't you glad the Lord Jesus loves you, and we love you very much, and we want to say happy birthday and happy anniversary to each of you who celebrated a birthday or anniversary this week, and we speak peace and blessing on you in the name of Jesus. We want to continue to pray for our church family. We're thinking about Terry recovering from wrist surgery and Sonny and Lindy with the cancer treatments. And we also want to remember to pray for our communities and certainly for our nation, and that the Lord would hasten an end to this time, and also that all of the things He would like to take advantage of during this time, He would be able to do that. And so we do pray this will draw to a quick end.
This week, I've been thinking about Esther's story from the Old Testament and the great testimony of her obedience. God was able to use her in such a mighty way to deliver His people. Throughout the book of Esther, she demonstrates her willingness to change and adapt to her circumstances. I've been thinking about her story with these questions. What if Esther had been more influenced by her past as an orphan than her current role as the queen? What if she had focused on all that she had lost instead of what she had been given in her new life as queen? In Esther chapter 4, verse 14, Mordecai spoke the famous challenge to her, "Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" Esther shows her obedience in her response to Mordecai from verse 16. And so I will go to the king, which is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. Esther's willingness to focus on using what the Lord had given her has been such a great example for generations of believers. So as we go throughout our week, let's try to focus on her example of leaving our past in the past and using what the Lord has given us today. Paul states it this way in Philippians 3:13-14. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things that are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So let's remember that we too have been called for such a time as this.
We're going to talk today about the ministry of the believer, and I want to read some scriptures out of 2 Corinthians in the 5th chapter. These, of course, will be very familiar to you, but we'll read down from verse 17 into the first part of chapter 6. In verse 17 of 2 Corinthians 5, it says, "Therefore, if any person be in Christ, he or she is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. All things are of God, who has reconciled us to Himself and given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the ministry of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For He hath made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. We then, as workers together with Him, beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain." So we notice in these verses that He is talking to us really about the ministry of the believer, and that we are to work together with God. He highlights this again in the 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 6 through 9, after giving them some correction, or really as a part of their correction, about having factions in their midst. He would give this exhortation to them. He said, "I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planted anything, neither he that waters, but God that gives the increase. Now he that plants and he that waters are one, and every person shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. We are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry, you are God's building." So today, as we highlight the ministry of the believer, every Christian has this ministry from the Lord Jesus, and it is referred to as the ministry of the believer. In this ministry, the individual's personal relationship with the Lord is the active ingredient. The ministry of the believer is an extension of the ministry of the Lord Jesus. The New Testament says of you and I that we are, our believers are, the body of Christ. The ministry of the believer is you and I and the Lord Jesus doing things together. You and the Lord doing the things that He wants to do with you. It is the Lord's expression through you, unique to you. We need you being you in Christ. You don't lose your personal identity in Christ. It simply becomes more pristine. I want to read from the last of Matthew in the 28th chapter in these verses that we call the Great Commission, and beginning in verse 18 down through verse 20. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." We want to highlight out of those verses, and I put them all in capital letters on in my notes, "whatsoever I have commanded you." And of course, we understand that he would be saying to us as a whole of what the Bible would say to you and I. But this week, this was the connotation that I had, are the things that the Lord is talking to you and expressing through you, and the things that He has put in your heart, that those are the things that you and I will eventually minister to our fellow believers and to the world. It is the expression, the experience of you and the Lord that ultimately reveals the Lord. The Great Commission is spoken to all believers, each person. Your supply is unique to you, and it is very important. We want to look at some Bible examples of people who would work together with the Lord. We call these people sometimes Bible characters. But Bible characters are simply people who walked with God and yielded to His plan and embraced His purpose for them for their lives. I want to read out of the book of Philemon, or Philemon, however you would pronounce it, in verse 6, Philemon 1 and 6. Before we begin, it says that the communication of your faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. I want to talk first of all about Abram and Sarai. We can translate the things we just read in Philemon to what God accomplished in Abram and Sarai. In Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 5, it says, "When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me, and be thou perfect or upright, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will multiply you exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, As for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your seed after you." Later in the chapter, in verses 15 and 16, he would talk concerning Sarai. "And God said to Abraham, As for Sarai thy wife, thou shalt not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name, and I will bless her, and give thee a son also of her, and I will bless her, and she will be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her." We see as they each accepted who and what they were in God and were willing to embrace their calling, if you will, the blessing manifested to them and the world by being who they really were in Him. And you'll notice God never again referred to them by the names of Abram and Sarai, but what He had called them, and they did likewise. The next person we would look at is Joshua. And I would read from Joshua in the first chapter, in verses 1 down through 9. It says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord came and spake to Joshua the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise and go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land which I do give them, even to the children of Israel. And every place that the sole of your foot shall tread, that have I given you, as I said unto Moses. from the wilderness of this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all of the land of the Hittites, unto the great sea, toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coasts. There shall not any man be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so will I be with you. I will not fail you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shall you divide for an inheritance of the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Turn not from it to the right hand nor to the left, that you may prosper in the things that you do. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever you go. Joshua certainly received much from Moses. Moses was his mentor. He received much influence from Moses. But to fulfill the purpose that the Lord had for him, he had to embrace the things that the Lord was saying to him. His success did not come in trying to be Moses, but by resting in what the Lord had commanded him. Joshua, for this assignment, would have to be Joshua. And the New Testament will show Joshua as a type and shadow of the Lord Jesus by leading the children of Israel into the Promised Land. Another person that we would like to look at is from the New Testament, John the Revelator. And we'll notice from 1 John in the first chapter the things that he says to you and I. Beginning in the first verse of 1 John, he says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For this life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with His Son, Jesus Christ." So we see John living his experience for our benefit. The next person we would look at would be the Apostle Paul. And I would read from Galatians 2 and 20, where Paul would say, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God." And so we want to highlight that Paul, in that statement, particularly made mention when he was talking about Jesus. He said he was the Son of God, and then he said, "who loved me." That Paul really believed the Lord loved him. And as you and I grow in confidence about how much the Lord loves us, then we again will express the Lord and be a mirror to that love. He would say in his letter to the church at Philippi in the third chapter, he would share with us really his hope. And he would say in the fourth verse that if anyone would have confidence in the flesh, then he should. And he began to rehearse that he was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, being a Hebrew of the Hebrews, and so on and so forth. But down in verse 8, he would say, "Yet doubtless I or in verse 7, what things were gained to me, I count those things as loss for Christ. In verse 8, he says, yes, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I might win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I might know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ. His highest aim was to try to get a hold of what had a hold of him. He would say in his letter to the church at Ephesus, I was made a minister according to the gift of grace, the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of His power. And Paul would draw on that and endeavor to rest in that grace. In his letter to the church at Colossae, he would say, wherefore I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest unto His saints, to whom God would make known what are the riches of His glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. I want to read again Philemon 1 and 6 as we close. Paul, when he wrote to Philemon, said that the communication of your faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ. And it is from the Apostle Paul that we learn so much about who we are in Christ Jesus and what the Lord has done for you and I in the passion, the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we can ask this question, what's Christ doing in me? Well, He is wanting to express His grace, His Spirit, His anointing in and through the Christian, the Christian, for our own lives and for the ministry of the believer that we are each called unto. In Matthew 28, in verse 20, in that part of the Great Commission when He said for us the things that He commanded us, whatsoever I have commanded you. The word commanded really means enjoined. So when He gave us that exhortation to expound the things that He has commanded us, He is meaning the things that He has enjoined to us, the things that He has birthed into us, that we are to exhibit those, and they are part of our ministry of the believer. Well, we love each of you very much, and we miss you, and we look forward to getting to meet back here together as a church family. And so we'll close with prayer. Father, we thank you so much for the Lord Jesus, and I pray, Lord, all of the things that you're wanting to do with and in each of us, that you would be able to do that, Father, that you would be able to express yourself through each of us, Lord, and that we would rest in you and rest in your grace and be ourselves in you, Father, and to thank you for your grace abounding in our lives. We're glad you love us, Father. We surround each of our church family with faith and love in the name of Jesus. We pray, Father, that it would be well with them and their households and their extended families. And we thank you that your grace would abound to every person, that you keep us safe, that you protect us, Lord. And we ask you to hasten the end of this time. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.